Thanks.
Great. This is Terry Cross, Senior Advisor at the National Indian Child Welfare Association. I want to thank you for joining us and say good afternoon to everybody, except our friends in Alaska, and I'll say good morning still. And you'll see on the right-hand side of your screen a chat box, and if you would please just introduce yourself in that chat box to other people, we'll know who's on with us. We're going to get started here in just a few minutes. I'll be giving some overview and background in the first few slides, and then turning it over to Andy, who will go into depth on the funding opportunity announcement, the FOA. We have several people who've joined us so far, and we expect to have a few more join us within the next few minutes. So I think, let's see, we've got, I see a few numbers that have called in, so please, if you click at the bottom of your chat box, type your name, you can introduce yourself. And there's mine. Francine, good morning. Thanks for joining us. Andy, our co-presenter. Georgia, thanks for joining us. Alton and Robin, good afternoon, Robin. Hey. And our attendance list is growing, so I hope that people continue to put your name in the chat box. So I think our list is pretty well has the people. I see Corey's joined us, University of Arizona, and Rebecca from Pascoyaki. Thank you for joining us. Well, I want to begin now with our presentation, and this is a call, a webinar about the funding opportunity announcement for the Systems of Care grants that were announced on February 16th. Andy's going to be going over that funding announcement in detail. I just want to say that one of the reasons that I have been involved in this System of Care work for almost 30 years now, and specifically with this grant program and technical assistance for 20 years, is that it's one of the most important and flexible funding sources for children's mental health in Indian Country. It has one of the highest participation rates of tribes of any federal program that's open to all governments, and with alongside states and cities and counties, tribes have had a good proportion of the grants that have come out of SAMHSA and the Center for Mental Health Services and Child, Adolescent, Families branch. And as you see from this the introductory screen, SAMHSA's underlying important mission of behavioral health is essential to health, prevention works, treatment is effective, and people recover. This has been so important to our work at in Indian Country as we have dealt with the historic trauma and the disparities in health and social conditions. So we're real pleased that once again there's a funding opportunity for states, counties, cities, and tribes and territories for the program that we call the Systems of Care grants, and Andy will talk a little bit more about the official title. The goals of this webinar are to increase understanding of the purpose and goals of the Comprehensive Community Mental Health Services for Children and Their Families program. This is the long title that we refer to as Systems of Care, to walk through each element of the funding opportunity announcement and encourage tribal applications and answer any questions you have. And that third point, encouraging tribal applications, this is a great year to be submitting an application, partly because of timing, the opportunity, this is a great opportunity year with a number of grants that will be made, and I'm going to turn it over to Andy to have him discuss the program history and purpose and move right into the presentation on the funding opportunity announcement.
All right. Thank you, Terry. So I appreciate everybody who is on the line calling in, and I recognize several names on the list there in the chat. So I will give you just a brief introduction of myself. I am Andy Hunt. I am an enrolled member of the Lumbee Indian Tribe of North Carolina. I'm a commissioned officer in the U.S. Public Health Service. I've been here at SAMHSA in the Center for Mental Health Services working with these grants for the last 10 years. Prior to that, I was with IHS for 15 years and was a clinical service provider and a tribal mental health director out in Washington, and worked with Terry for almost 6 years at NICWA as a technical assistance provider for the Circles of Care and Systems of Care grantees. So I've seen this grant program from multiple angles, and I'm glad that you have called in and that you were interested. And this is going to be a fast-paced presentation, so I hope you will excuse my fast talking. I guess you could say I've lived in the East Coast long enough now that I've learned to speak fast, because sometimes when you're in meetings in the East Coast, if you don't speak fast, nobody lets you talk. So I'm going to use those skills, hopefully not talking too fast for you guys. My hope is that everyone has already printed out a copy of the funding opportunity announcement that's on the website, and you've had a chance to review it, but we're just going to go walk through it today. Before we do that, a little bit of background on the history of the community mental health grant program. That's the long title that we just call Systems of Care. So it started in 1993. That's when it was first funded. This is funded by a law, by an amendment to the Public Health Service Act. So there is a line item in SAMHSA's budget specifically for this. The funding has increased since it first started. So we have awarded a total of 299 grants since the beginning. Out of those, 46 are tribal grantees, which is 50% of all awards. And just a note, for the purpose of our count of 46, we are also counting a handful of cities, counties, and states that got applications and were specifically focused on working with urban Indian or tribal communities. So we count them in that total also. So you can just see over the years, most recently, the number of total grants in black, and then in parentheses in red, the number of tribal awards that were given. This past year, I was a bit disappointed that we only funded one tribal grant out of 24 grants. Part of that was because we just did not have very many applications. So I'm really hoping that this presentation will inspire you guys to apply. This is a great year to do so. Just a little bit of perspective, kind of looking at dots on the map. This is all of the grants that were funded from 1993 to 2010, which was when the grants were 5 and 6 year cooperative agreements. These are technically, these are cooperative agreements. I will say grants just because that's easier to say. A cooperative agreement means that SAMHSA's involvement is more more active than with a regular grant. So we've got states, almost every state has had at least one system of care grant over the years. Then our current, the current awards that are going on right now, it's a little bit different look of the map, but we can see that we're still pretty much covering all of the states. There are a few states that don't have any current grants, and I don't have a breakdown or a map specifically of the tribes. But, this is just a little bit about SAMHSA's theory of change. The System of Care Expansion and Sustainability Grant Program, as we're calling it this this round, is really intended to take the concept of systems of care from what 20 plus years ago was an innovative approach to up to the wide scale adoption. So we feel like we have spent enough time in systems of care communities that we know it works. It looks different in every community, but we still know that it works. So we want to expand this to the broader world. One of the things that you should be aware of, just another broad piece of context, is the CMHS, or CMS and SAMHSA joint bulletin, which is something that is allowing Medicaid billing for all of these, what I would call sort of out-of-the-box, non-traditional, non-Western approaches to providing services for children with mental health issues. So this is really about doing more than just the 50-minute hour standard approach to mental health. So this is something I hope that you can go back later and download this document and see that there's a tremendous opportunity to sustain the services that can be started with this grant through the mechanisms that are put in place with the informational bulletin. All right, so with that, we're going to launch into walking through the funding opportunity announcement. There's the numbers, in case you haven't already looked it up. Those are the funding opportunity announcement number and the CDFA number. Excuse me. So a couple of highlights. The application is due April 25th. We expect between 17 to 53 grants to be awarded this year. The awards are up to $3 million for states that are doing statewide interventions, and up to $1 million for political subdivisions of states, meaning cities or counties, also territories, and tribes or tribal organizations. So tribes can ask for up to $1 million a year. There is a federal match required, which we'll talk about later. This is a four-year projected grant, and the eligible applicants are public entities, which we will identify and describe a little bit later in the application, but it's basically governmental entities. So cities, counties, states, tribes, and territories. Okay, so then the funding opportunity announcement begins with outlining the purpose. So the purpose of this grant is to focus on children and youth between birth and age 21 who have, quote, a serious emotional disturbance. We may not like that language. It doesn't really feel warm and fuzzy or feel like it fits within our tribal communities and perspectives of how we think of emotional wellness and things like that. But that's what the law calls it, serious emotional disturbance. So that's what we're held accountable for. So that's the language that we will be using. This grant is primarily for the purpose of creating a sustainable infrastructure along with services. So if you're looking at this as just a grant to provide services for your youth for 4 years, then you're only seeing part of the picture. This really is about sustaining, expanding, and sustaining a system of care approach. This is specifically for mental health and related recovery support services to children and youth with SED and their families. Also included in this announcement is the inclusion of first episode psychosis. So we want people to be aware of that and provide intervention for children who might be at risk for that. We're encouraging to address health disparities, which is part of why we're encouraging tribal grantees. After the purpose, the FOA runs through the set of expectations between pages 7 and 11. So again, this is to develop infrastructure and deliver services. Services are expected to begin through this grant 6 months after the award. And you may already be providing services because you are a service providing agency. We're not telling that you can't, you know, you have to stop providing services, whatever you're doing. We're just saying that within the context of this grant and what you're proposing with this grant, you've got 6 months to sort of ramp up and plan for how you're going to do things in a different way. Because while we're asking you to provide services, we're not asking you to provide just the same old services. There are two levels of applications, as I kind of mentioned earlier. States can apply for statewide expansion, and then other political subdivisions, including tribes, tribal organizations. State applicants that are applying have to identify at least two local jurisdictions that are not currently receiving implementation grant funds. And these are essentially local demonstration sites or local labs for the statewide expansion. This is a little note here in red that I added. This is not in the FOA, but something I wanted to make sure that you are aware of. If your tribe is not ready to apply on your own, you may want to discuss with your state if they can add you as a local jurisdiction. So that's another alternative of how you might benefit as a tribe from this grant without having to actually apply on your own if for whatever reason the tribe is not ready to do so. Okay, we'll skip through the rest of that. So for political subdivisions, including tribes and tribal organizations, we expect applicants to demonstrate that they have a working relationship with the state. So this is not doing anything to take away from tribal sovereignty or anything like that. It's more acknowledging the reality that the state has a role in the provision of mental health services to your community, especially Medicaid. State runs Medicaid. So we want to see that tribes have some sort of relationship or preparing a relationship to work with tribes. We want to see that there's some sort of linkage with the state lead agency for mental health services. We want to make sure that there is a commitment from the tribe to making broad system changes. Some of the other expectations we have are really talking about, again, the wide-scale adoption of the systems of care approach. So if you don't know what we mean by the system of care approach, then you may want to do some homework on that. We expect grantees to provide biannual reports. We expect grantees to fully involve families and youth in the development, implementation, and evaluation of the grant program. We expect grantees to either develop or enhance an existing governance structure that can help to implement the system of care approach. So this may be for tribes that may be working with your tribal council to help them understand what the system of care approach is and how they, as a governing body for the whole tribe, can help create policy change. Or you may decide that you want to create a separate advisory board that has a relationship with the tribal council. That's really up to you, but we do want to make sure that there is a community body that is providing guidance to the program. So we also expect you to work with any other SAMHSA tribal youth treatment programs that are in your area. One of the expectations is developing a social marketing and communication plan. This is due by the end of the first year of the grant award. So this is about creating social marketing messages. And this does not mean just creating a website and Facebook. We're not talking about social media. We're talking about social marketing of children's mental health and systems change. So identifying how you're going to come up with a plan to deal with issues of discrimination and stigma for children with mental health, how you're going to identify ways that people can work together and come to a common understanding for what a system of care means. That's what we're expecting with the social marketing and communication strategic plan. You're also required to develop a strategic financing plan by the end of year two. Again, this is with the idea that this is an expansion and sustainability grant program. We expect you to sustain the services that you've developed with this grant through both infrastructure, policy procedures, things like that, and also a funding process. There are some key positions that we require. Those are three of the main key positions: our principal investigator, a project director, which we expect to be at least three quarters, preferably full-time FTE, and then a lead family contact, who is lead family contact is typically a non-professional community member who is a family member of a child who has an emotional severe emotional disturbance or other mental health issues. We also expect you to identify what we're calling task leads for these five key programmatic aspects of the grant. So these can be shared positions or it can be, we're not really telling you exactly how you need to do this, but we're basically telling you somebody needs to be in charge and take lead of clinical service delivery. Somebody needs to take charge and be leading cultural competence evaluation, social marketing, and youth engagement. How you decide to do that is up to you, but we do want to make sure that it's clear that there is some leadership in those topic areas. If you are funded, then you will be expected to develop a health disparities impact statement no later than 60 days after the award. We expect you to use these grant funds to provide services to youth who are not currently covered under whatever services for insurance or anything else. And we expect you to promote the process of recovery and consider the needs of any returning vets and their families. The population of focus for this grant, again, is ages birth to 21. This is for children who have a diagnosed mental health disorder that's diagnosable under the DSM, or if you're working with early childhood, there's some other classification, the diagnostic tools that we will also acknowledge. In addition to having a diagnosis, the this is all language from the legislation. That there has to be a disability, limited functioning, and it has to last for a year or be expected to last more than 1 year. So we're not looking at kids with things like adjustment disorder, things like that. This is really for children with more serious mental health issues. The other thing that we are encouraging grants to think about is to providing services to individuals who, again, are at risk of having a first episode psychosis. Kids who are involved with juvenile justice or primary care or child welfare, education. So you may choose as part of your grant, even though the population of focus is birth to 21, you don't have to serve birth to 21 every child under 21. You may, depending on what your needs are, want to focus on a specific subpopulation of age group. So you may want to focus on early childhood, or you may want to focus on older youth, or that's up to you. You can do the whole thing or any segment of it. You may also say that you're going to focus just on youth involved in the juvenile justice system. That's entirely up to you. We do expect you to deal with youth who have co-occurring disorders, again, early childhood, and integration between mental health and primary care. Then we go into the required activities under the funding announcement. This is primarily a infrastructure and services grant. So the funding opportunity announcement asks or provides you with up to 30% of the grant funds being for the purpose of infrastructure development. Now, if I were you, I would say this when I say up to, it really means 30%. We do expect you to be focusing on the infrastructure that will sustain the services after the grant is over. In this part of the infrastructure, what we're talking about reviewing policies and regulations around mental health services in your community. We are expecting that services will be delivered in a culturally and linguistically competent way, which is what Terry mentioned earlier when he talked about flexibility. This is where our tribal grantees have really taken and run with the idea of culturally based services, and that can look however it looks in your community, whatever your tribal culture is, even with the differences within your own culture, within your own community. So we acknowledge that and we encourage that. We also strongly encourage and in fact require family-driven and youth-guided care to be provided. So we expect the family members and the youth themselves who are going to be recipients of services to be involved at every level of the process. Once again, it says that families and youth are integrally involved in the planning, governance, implementation, evaluation, and oversight. We expect that you will develop a mechanism that promotes the sustaining youth and family participation, either through peer support, leadership, or partnership. And we want you to expand the use of peer support providers, which could include family and youth. This is also another place where some tribes have used traditional healers as peer support providers. So that's, again, entirely up to you to how you define exactly what peer support providers are beyond family and youth. So if you have heard family-driven and youth-guided several times through the course of this this presentation, that should tell you something about how important we think that is in this program. The other required activities is that we expect you to be collaborating across child-serving agencies. and between the child and adult servicing agencies for older adults. So this, while this is a grant program for children with mental health issues, this is not strictly a mental health program. We're not expecting you to develop just a mental health empire in your behavioral health clinic or organization. This is a cross-agency, cross-serving. So we expect you to be working with your child welfare, your juvenile justice, your education, your substance abuse, your primary care. This is a collaborative approach. It's not about building up a particular program. This really is a change initiative. We do expect you and require you to integrate some sort of crisis response strategy to deal with trauma-related activities and to engage in outreach and engagement strategies. So not waiting for people to come knocking on the door asking for services, but to actually go out and provide encouragement to reach the youth who may not be asking for services on their own. We expect you to create flexible funds, which can be used to provide unique services to specific children and families to meet their unique needs. So this can be a variety of ways, but we do expect you to develop a policy around using flex funds, and we have quite a bit of guidance on how exactly how to do that. We expect you to collaborate this grant with any other SAMHSA grants that you may happen to receive. The services that we expect you to provide or have available are listed here. There's 9 different, so basically a comprehensive services. This is not saying that you and your organization have to provide these to everybody all the time. So a lot of tribes are nervous about the 24/7 hour emergency services, saying that, well, we don't have that. We rely on our county, or we have some other mechanism with the hospital in town or something like that. So we just expect these to be available to implement and expand and operate these services. That not that you have to do them all yourselves, but you may have arrangements with other entities and organizations to help provide this when needed. So respite care is a good example. Not everyone needs respite care, but when it is available, you should have a process in place that is something that you can provide. Some other allowable activities that we will let you use the grant for is to coordinate with other existing grant programs that are serving the same population. So many of you have different grant programs that are focused on youth suicide prevention or things like that. So we do expect you to coordinate, not overlap, but coordinate efforts. You can use the funds to do needs assessments. You can use it to adopt or enhance computer management or electronic health records. And you can use this grant to help support any kind of behavioral health or telebehavioral health and other things, things like that. So these are things that you may or may not choose to do. Just because it says telehealth, that doesn't mean we expect you to do that. Just means that if that is going to work in your area and that's something that makes sense to you, then by all means, you can do that. Some of the other allowable, I would say encouraged, on this is a little bit stronger, just for the purpose of sustainability, is that we expect you to highlight some innovative financing strategies. And this is going to look different in each of your communities. If you're a Tribal 638 program and you're able to be billing the all-inclusive rate under IHS, and that gives you a whole different set of financing strategies than a direct IHS, a direct service tribe that is not operating their own clinic and has to you know, to find other ways. So depending on what your situation is and what your context is, this may look different, but again, we're really hoping and encouraging and expecting that you'll be continuing these services beyond the 4 years of the grant. So with that, I'm going to pause a bit. I see there were some questions in the chat. I did see a question about somebody was asking about how many grants are going to be awarded, and I believe the funding opportunity announcement says between 17 and 53. So let's see if I can go back to that slide.
There it is.
So there's between 17 to 53 awards will be made. This is for cities, counties, states, tribes, territories. Depending on how many applicants we get, how many states. So if we get 17 states that apply for a full $3 million and they all score at the top of the range, then they will get funded all the way. Now, that's probably not very likely. So if no states applied for the statewide, then we would have 53 $1 million grants. So it really depends. As Terry said earlier, if you are a tribe and you're thinking about applying, this is a great year to do it because we have quite a bit of money that we are going to be that we have available. So we can't say exactly how many there are because it sort of depends on who applies and how the applications are scored. Terry, did I miss any other questions?
No, I would just say that is $1 million a year for the 4 years, you might want to talk about the match requirement. I know that'll come up in a few minutes, but also that you don't have to ask for the full amount if you're a small tribe or a smaller program. It might make more sense to ask for less and do what you can achieve with a smaller amount of money.
Right. So the $1 million is maximum per year for tribes. And as Terry said, that may be realistic for you, or it may be completely unrealistic. So you may look at this and say, well, we can do this in our community for $400,000 a year or whatever. But that is that's kind of the gist of that. We will get more into we're just starting, so a lot of the questions might be answered later, specifically related to match. So I see Robin's typing an answer, but we're going to go ahead and press forward. And Robin's asking to mention if this is only for people without insurance. No. You can serve children who have insurance, but you can't use the grant funds to pay for it. You can kind of look at the grant funds as a payer of last resort. So if you have children who are on Medicaid, then we're not saying that you can't serve them. If they have private insurance, we're not saying you can't serve them. We're just saying that the grant fund should the direct service grant fund should only be used for youth who are not provided any insurance. And the question about IHS, if there's a, obviously if you're on a reservation and you're serving youth who live on the reservation, then they're going to be probably getting their services at IHS. If they're not already getting mental health services because mental health services don't exist, then that's a different question. But we're expecting that you will coordinate with your IHS providers. So you can't use the funds to supplant. There's a whole section on that in the funding opportunity announcement. So, you can't say, we're going to hire three clinicians with the system of care grant, And we're going to take our three IHS clinicians and put them somewhere else so that the new people can do their job. We can't do that. But if there are specific questions that are particular to your situation, then I will be available for questions between now and when the grant is due. So if you want to email me at some point later with specific questions as you're sort of thinking through it, then we can always do that later. So this is just meant to be an overview.
Andy, this is. I would just add to what you said that because this is a grant program meant to change systems and have the way that services are provided, that the inclusion of IHS in that system redesign part of the work is really an important part of the work if IHS is one of the providers for children's mental health.
Right, yeah. I mean, they're all of the you're going to need to work with all the providers in your community, whether that's a tribal provider or a county provider or the IHS direct service, whoever it is. We really want to see all the everybody playing in the sandbox nicely together. So let's talk a little bit, move on, about the data collection and performance measurement. So grantees are required to collect and report data. After all, we're giving you money, Congress, we're giving you Congress's money, and they want to know if you're using it the way, if it's making a difference and you're using the way that is intended to you. So we're required to have you collect data through the GIPRA process. I'll say a little bit, there's two types of GIPRA data. One is what we call infrastructure measures, and there are six infrastructure measures for this grant program. They're identified on page 16 of the RFA, if this slide is correct. I don't have the FOA in front of me. There's six infrastructure measures that you need to report on quarterly, and I'll just tell you this, it's not a big deal. The things that you're counting, if you look at the funding opportunity, this is not the work of a PhD spending hours a day working on this. That's really not a big deal. Look at it don't overthink it, would be my message about the infrastructure measures. The direct service data is a different story. There is a direct service data that is collected on anybody that's getting services through this grant program. So that can be, again, that can be children that you're funding through this grant, or it could be children whose you're coordinating services that they may be getting services at IHS or at a county. So we want to make sure that we're collecting data on any child that's being touched by the system of care program. So there's a little bit more involved in this because you're doing a baseline 6 months and discharge on this piece. So this is where you do need some people who are trained in collecting data. The other thing about the local performance assessment is that we're expecting you to kind of be checking yourself for quality improvement. So you're doing performance reporting. Your notice of award, if you get funded, will tell you exactly when this is due, but it's at least an annual report. Typically, we do two reports a year, and that's a programmatic progress report that's just basically a narrative in addition to the GIPRA report. You can use no more than 20% of the total grant for data collection, performance measurement, and assessment. If there's any questions about this, feel free to type it in the chat box if you have any question about data collection. I don't know if it's in the FOA, I didn't see it in the slides. There may also be a system of care specific national evaluation for a longitudinal study. I'm not sure and that's something that we've done in the past. I'm not sure what the status is, but that is for this. We may be rolling in the client level GIPR data for that. So seeing no questions in the text box, I'm going to move on. We've still got lots of ground to cover. Part of what you get in addition to the funds for this grant is technical assistance that we provide through a contract. SAMHSA has a contract with the University of Maryland, who has created a technical assistance network, a TA network, and one of the subcontracts that the TA network has is with NICWA, National Indian Child Welfare Association, to provide technical assistance to our tribal grantees. So one of the many ways that you'll be getting technical assistance, if you're funded, is through a grantee meeting. We expect you to travel 10 people, at least, to at least one system of care training activity each year. Sometimes this is a large system of care grantee meeting. Other times this is smaller regional meetings. It really depends on a lot of things that are kind of beyond our control to project out. But we do expect you to be traveling at least 10 people for these meetings. The purpose of this is for technical assistance and to hear from our experts and also to build some relationships between you and the other grantees. So all of the tribal grantees will have meetings together, and then you'll also have the opportunity to meet with and network with our city, county, and state grantees. So we will also be offering a variety of virtual training events, webinars, and other things like that that we do expect you to participate in. All right, so the next section in the FOA is the award information. So once again, proposed budgets cannot exceed $3 million for state applicants and $1 million for tribes and tribal organizations. This does include both direct and indirect. So if your tribe has a 25% indirect rate and you request the $1 million, then you will charge your indirect rate off of that so that you will have $750,000 of direct service or direct cost, and your 25% would be your indirect cost. So whatever your bona fide certified indirect rate is, you are allowed to charge that if you choose to. You don't have to either. If your indirect rate is 55% and you don't want to have all of your money going to your tribal administration, you want to use it for services, and you can talk them into passing on the indirect rate, you are allowed to do that also. But you can use your indirect rate if you have one. So this is a four-year grant, but you are required to reapply through a continuation application every year. And we walk you through that process when the time comes. All right, so eligibility, we've already kind of talked about this. This is statutorily limited to public entities. So this is for states, tribes, and territories. So obviously, if you are an Indian tribe and you are on the Department of Interior list of federally recognized tribes, then you are eligible. If you are a tribal organization sanctioned by one of those 66 federal recognized tribes, then you are a tribal organization. So if you have any question, obviously if you're a tribe on the list, then that's easy to identify. Most tribal organizations are easy to identify. There are some cases where people say, well, I think I'm a tribal organization, but I'm not sure. So if that's the situation, you can always call me and we'll talk about it. This also includes tribal colleges and universities are considered tribal organizations. Urban Indian organizations are not considered tribal organizations. They are not a public entity. They're a private nonprofit. So they are not eligible to apply for the grant. Neither are state-recognized tribes. So the territories are also eligible to apply. And there's some information about grants that were awarded in 13, 14, and 15. It basically means if you are currently a system of care grant and you will be a current, you will be a grantee next year, then you're not eligible. If you are a current system of care grant that will end in September 29th of this year, then you would be eligible to apply because your grant would be over. Okay, let's move on from that. One other point. So the third bullet there. So let's say that your tribe says, you know, we don't really feel like we're ready to apply on our own, or maybe you want to apply on your own. You want to kind of hedge your bets and talk with your state to say, you know, hey, state, can we be one of your local jurisdictions in your application? We're going to submit our own application, but we're not, you know, we're not sure if we're going to get funded, so we want to also be considered a local jurisdiction. Now, if you do that and you apply, you can't apply for both. However, you cannot receive both. So if your application scored higher than the state, then you would get funded by yourself. If the state scored better than yours, then the state would get funded and you would be a local jurisdiction under them. You would not get the grant directly. So you can't get the same grant twice. So here's where we get into the match requirements. This is, again, this is part of the statute. As much as we've heard you know, complaints and you know, challenges around this before, there is no waiver. This is in the statute. We have had we've tried to get it waived in the past, and have come up with rulings from the Office of the Inspector General that this is not waivable. So for the first 3 years of this grant, it is a 1-to-3 match ratio, meaning that for every three federal funds, you have to come up with one local dollar. So if you request $1 million, then you need to come up with $333,333 in non-federal funds to support the work of the grant. So your total budget will actually be, you know, 1.3 and change, including your non-federal contributions. Because this is about sustainability, because you can sort of look at this grant as a venture capital where we're giving you money hoping that you will take off and run with it, the fourth year the match increases to a 1-to-1 rate. So for every $1 that you get, you need to provide $1 in non-federal match. So if you get $1 million in your last year, then you will need to provide $1 million in non-federal match. So it should be noted that if you receive IHS or BIA 638 funds, you may count those towards match if they are used to support the work of the grant. That doesn't mean you can take your whole $1 million IHS mental health contract and count that as match towards this program, because you're probably not using all that to support the work of this grant. So it really does, everything you do with the non-federal match has to be specifically for this grant program, not just a general fund of pool of funds. And we have a lot of technical assistance around this. There is a webinar that we just did earlier this week that talks all about match. I'm assuming that somehow when you review this, you'll be able to click on that, watch the webinar link and find that webinar. Okay, so other eligible information. We do want to make sure that the application, the applicant, shows that the identified needs are consistent with the priority of the tribe. So in other words, this is basically to prevent a project director working for the tribe running a program saying, oh, I want to apply for this, and sort of getting an application in without the buy-in of the tribe itself. So we want to be sure that this application is consistent with the priorities of the tribe and fully backed up with you know, with the tribal support, and provide some sort of documentation that children's mental health reform, systems reform for children is one of the priorities of the tribe. So if you don't have an existing such documentation, then you know, you could do something like a tribal resolution or a letter from your tribal chairman or something like that. But we do want to make sure that this is consistent with the goals of the tribe itself. With that, any questions about eligibility? I saw there were a couple questions that Terry asked and answered in the chat box. So I think it's pretty straightforward in terms of eligibility. We do have some more slides to go through still, so I'll just keep going. All right, so this is the part four that talks about the process of submitting an application. So it is important to note that SAMHSA is doing all grant applications through grants.gov. So you, if you have not done submitted a grant through grants.gov, then I would suggest between now and, or sometime next week, that you do some homework and figure out how you need to do that and get everything set up so that when it comes time to submit that you're set up to use the system. In addition to the identified information that the federal financial forms, you'll need to include this list, which is basically pulled from the funding opportunity announcement. Project narrative can be no longer than 35 pages. The project narrative, I'll get to that later, that's what you are, what your grant, the application is ranked on. That's it. Those 35 pages, how you answer all the questions in sections A through E is how you are scored. All this other information is important to support the application, but the actual scoring is done through that project narrative. So that's extremely important. The applications are due before 11:59 Eastern Time on April 25th. And it has to be submitted through grants.gov. You can't email it to anybody at SAMHSA. Please don't email it to me because I don't have any way to do anything with it. If you, for whatever reason, you feel like you cannot submit something through grants.gov, there is a process for requesting a waiver to submit a paper application. So if you think that you want to do that, then look at how to do that in Appendix B of the application. This is a very important tip that I want to emphasize. I can't emphasize enough. As much as I say it, there's always people who don't think that I really mean it. Please do not wait until April 25th, the due date, to start submitting your application in grants.gov. There have been many occasions where people have run into a variety of glitches, whether it was on their end or with grants.gov, and it kicked out the application that wasn't reviewed. So do you really want to spend, you know, 45 days of writing this grant for nothing, not even have it reviewed because you waited till the last minute? Please don't put yourself in this situation. We do suggest that you try to start putting it in 3 days early. There's no penalty in submitting early, but there is a severe penalty for submitting late, which is your grant won't be reviewed. So please, 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 please do not wait until the last minute to do this. All right. There is some funding restrictions and limits on the grant. In the funding opportunity announcement, we've talked about it before. No more than 20% of the grant can be used for data collection, performance measurement, and performance assessment. No more than 30% may be awarded for infrastructure. Again, I would encourage you to use the full 30% of this developed towards infrastructure, because that's what's going to lead you to have a better chance at actually sustaining the grant. So this is an infrastructure grant as well as providing services. So you see that, you know, if you are following this formula, that if you maximize the evaluation and you maximize the amount on the infrastructure, then you still got 50% of your grant funds used to provide mental health services and supports. Then you will need to identify these funds in your budget. Okay, so there are other funding restrictions that you need to read Appendix D to make sure that you're not doing something like one of the common mistakes is construction. SAMHSA does not fund construction. It's not a fine line, but there is a difference between there is an allowability for renovation, which is different than construction. So we have had grantees in the past want to do something where they think that it's renovation, but when you look at what the federal contract grant definition of construction is, their renovation project is really a construction project and it gets disallowed. So if you're thinking about anything like that, I suggest you do some homework, and you might want to call and talk to Gwen Simpson. This number I'll give you later if you have anything that you think may fall into that category. I also want to be sure that you're aware that this grant cannot be used solely to support substance abuse treatment, and that's part of the statute as well. Okay, any questions on this? We've got a couple more sections to go in the slideshow. So if you have any questions as I'm talking, feel free to put it in the chat box. Terry is doing a good job of keeping up. Terry, is there anything that we should talk about in the text box that we may have missed?
No, I would just mention that your point about the money can't be used solely for substance abuse treatment, it's that shouldn't be construed as not having your substance abuse program as a full partner. And if it's part of the case, part of the plan for a child or family, that substance abuse treatment is needed, it can be part of the system of care configuration, part of that wraparound planning.
Right. If it's important for a child who or youth who has a co-occurring disorder, we fully expect you to partner with whoever your substance abuse services providers are. And you might say, well, we don't have any youth substance abuse providers. You can't use this grant to fund three substance abuse counselor positions, or two, or one. You can use it to support that if it's part of a plan, but it's not strictly a substance abuse treatment program. So again, we realize that co-occurring is an issue. So as Terry said, we're not saying you can't, you shouldn't be working with substance abuse providers, but this grant can't be used to fund them. Okay, so moving on, this gets into the important stuff. All of this is background. The application, this is the Section 5, the evaluation criteria. This is where the rubber meets the road in terms of your application. because, as I said earlier, the application will be scored according to the quality of responses in the project narrative, which is sections A through E. So I strongly suggest that you look at those bullet points in sections A through E on these pages, and that's the organization of your application should follow those bullet points. Whatever you're thinking about, you need to write them in terms of that. So as you're writing it, you have to indicate the letter and number in your response. So if you're addressing question A1, your application should say A1 and then describe how you're addressing that question. If you address something that's in A1, but you talk about it in C3, it doesn't matter, it won't get scored. So it has to be inserted in the right place or the reviewers will not score it. The other thing about the evaluation of your application, as I said, the budget and supporting documentations, they are not scored. They are reviewed. So if it looks like there are questions about your budget or other things like that, they will be addressed separately from the scoring. So you may score very high, and they may look at your budget and say, well, we've got some questions about this or that in the budget. That would be addressed either before or after the award was made, if your score was high enough to be funded. So there's a number after each section that tells you how much the maximum is worth for that particular section of the narrative. I said each bullet is assessed, so if you can imagine just a little bit about how SAMHSA grants are reviewed, they are reviewed by peer reviewers. So SAMHSA staff does not review this. We contract out the Office of Grants Review, which is separate from my office. They are in control of the process. They contract out with reviewers. Over the years, we have developed a pool of native reviewers, so you can be assured that at least one person on the triad, there's three people who read every grant, you can be assured that at least one person on the triad is almost certain to be a tribal member or someone who has worked extensively in tribal communities. And you can be assured that at least a couple, if not all three, of the reviewers are well-versed in the system of care grant program. So these are people who really know this program inside and out and know what they're reading. So they are the reviewers. They get copies of all the applications. So they may, a group of three may be asked to review 5 or 10 applications. What they're doing is they have a score sheet that's based strictly on the bullet questions on sections A through E. And they're asked to look at each of those bullet points and read your application and rate whether you minimally or fully, sort of on a 1 to 5 scale, how you addressed each of those bullet sections. So that's why I say that is the most important part of your application, is to make sure that you completely address each of those bullet points. If you don't, then you'll be scored accordingly. So here is the breakdown of the points allowed. There's the statement of need, which is 20 points. Proposed services and infrastructure approach, which is 25. The expectations and required activities, so how you're going to meet those things that we talked about earlier in the webinar, that's worth 30 points. The staff management and relevant experience is 15, and the data collection and evaluation is worth 10. So look at sort of the breakdown and think about how you would organize your application and what are the important parts to really make sure that you're addressing. So there you need to submit a budget with a complete justification, talking about existing resources and other support, which means your federal, non-federal sources. So you have to have a budget with a narrative. There is, I believe there's a template in the application packet. There's Appendix 2 has a sample budget. So we highly recommend that you use that that budget format. You have to make sure that your budget reflects the limitations or restrictions. So as a tribe, you can't submit an application with a budget of $3 million or $1.5 million. It cannot exceed $1 million. Make sure that you don't have anything like construction or any other excluded funds. And then the other thing is that you want to identify the costs clearly in your budget. You'll need to supply some supporting documentation. So this is biographical sketches and job descriptions. Just a note about this. While the reviewers do look at this and they try to see the quality of people that are you're proposing to be involved in the application, you know, in the grant if you're funded, just because you've identified John Smith, PhD, to be your project director, there's no guarantee that John Smith is, that's not a guarantee of employment. So something may happen. John Smith may leave, or you may, upon further review, figure that he's maybe not the best person for the job. So this is really more the type of person that you're interested in. So if you want to find the national expert on system of care and put their name in there, thinking that's going to increase your chances of being funded, this is not scored. It's something that is looked at by the reviewers in terms of, do you understand the type of person that it takes to run this type of grant? So I'll leave it that for there. Confidentiality and participant protection. So you'll need to address that, especially in terms of the evaluation, the GIPRA client level services. You're going to be asking people information. You also want to talk about how you're going to protect people as they're receiving services, confidentiality, reporting, all those sort of things. So again, that is not scored, but it is looked at. So if there are questions or concerns about it, if at some point it's reviewed and it feels there's a sense that you haven't covered this, then that will be addressed. Okay, I think we're almost done. I want to move on so we have some questions at the end. Administrative questions, there's reporting requirements. We won't go over this in detail other than say that there are reporting requirements, and if you're funded, then we'll make sure you know what those are. This is an important part that I want to emphasize again. So if you're not listening, if you're multitasking and doing something else, now is time to pay attention if you're writing this application. Unfortunately, there's a common practice that is not a legal practice, whereby the individual contractors are offering to write grant applications for tribes, and then also writing themselves into the application as a paid consultant. This is illegal. This is a violation of 45 CFR Part 74 competition. So you are free as a private contractor to help a tribe write a grant. They will thank you and possibly pay you for your grant writing skills, but you may not write yourself into the grant. If you do, then we will at some point have a very unpleasant conversation with yourself and some other people who you probably don't want to talk to. So please do not do this. If you are a contractor, if you do not work for a tribe, if you're not a tribal employee and you want to help a tribe, that's fine. Please be aware that you cannot write yourself in to a grant application. It's a violation of competition. So I will leave that. I will leave that there and move on to the next comment. Final tip: there is a really great toolkit for tribes to help you learn how to do better at grant writing that OJJDP has published. So if you go to this link, tribalyouthprogram.org, under OJJDP, you'll find a pretty cool toolkit that you can use that'll help you with some ideas with this grant. All right, so after you've submitted your application, obviously we want you to put together the best application that you can. If you, you know, you're going to spend a couple months hopefully getting people together to talk about the ideas and how you might actually put this together in an application. Hopefully you're not going to just pay John Smith, grant writer, to let him do all the work and deliver the tablet like coming Moses coming off the hill and say, here's your grant application, and then you get funded and you have no idea what it's about. I would strongly encourage you to not do that. This really should be a collaborative process, and you're going to bring people together to talk about this. So even if you don't get funded, the process of developing and writing this application can really plant the seed of systems change. I say this out of personal experience and personal knowledge. When I was with the Puyallup Tribal Health Authority in the 90s, I was the mental health director. We put together an application which, for technical reasons at the time, was not even reviewed, no fault of our own, but we didn't get funded. However, it created a sense that this is something that we can do, and we think we're going to move forward with these ideas even without the SAMHSA grant. So it can be done with the commitment of tribal leaders. The tribes, you can use your own existing resources and community support to start incorporating some of the ideas that you're going to talk about as you put together your application. So we really want you to get funded. You know, getting funded is a huge catalyst to helping move this forward. But if you do not get funded, or if you decide not to apply, hopefully what you've got out of it is you know, moving the needle forward on your systems change. The other important thing to note after the application, this is something that is also very important. If you are funded, a notice of award will be emailed directly to whoever is named as the business official on your grant application. This is emailed directly from SAMHSA's grants management. There is no paper copy. Your congressional, somebody from your congressional office is supposed to inform somebody at the tribe to say, congratulations, you've been funded. However, what's happened in the past is if you name your business official as your tribal council chairperson, and between now and September, there's an election and that person is no longer your tribal chairperson, it's still going to go to that person, and you may never, it may be sort of lost in translation. So it's important to make sure that whoever you name as business official is aware that they will be getting the notice of award. We do not know when the notice of awards will be sent out. It's up to the Office of Grants Management. Most likely it will be mid-September. If you haven't heard anything about your grant application by September 29th, that probably means you were not funded, because we anticipate the funding to start no later than September 30th of this year. And with that, we've got some time for questions. So I'm not sure if we want to open up the phone lines for any questions. We've got about 10 minutes.
Andy, before we do that, would you say a little bit about that 30% that can be spent on capacity building or system change, and in particular addressing the word infrastructure? And we had a great discussion with tribal leaders at NCAI a couple days ago about that.
Right. All right. So infrastructure. If you go talk to your tribal council and they're hot on economic development, you talk to them about infrastructure, they might think you're talking about building, T1 lines or roads or buildings or something like that. We're not talking about that kind of infrastructure. We're talking about things like policies and procedures, a memorandum agreements, contracts, regulations, tribal codes, tribal resolutions, the structure, sort of organizational structure. So if you're going through if your tribe recently went through a reorganization, then you have changed your infrastructure as part of that reorganization. So those are the sort of things we're talking about in terms of infrastructure. So it's changing, moving from what is commonly referred to as sort of a silo of you've got your mental health program here, your child welfare program there. Everybody's got their own little silos and their own little camps of services, and they don't work together. We're really interested in changing those silos and breaking down the walls, and how you do that in terms of reviewing your policies, procedures, hiring practices, all those sort of things that help create the structure of providing more comprehensive services that are family-driven and youth-guided. So one example of infrastructure around family-driven would be to create a structure whereby families are included in decision-making at policy levels, at program levels. So no decision is made about a new program or a new service or a new process in your health system without getting input from the families who are, essentially some people have said it's a customer service approach. That's another way sometimes tribal chair people and tribal councils can relate to that, because they tend to be more business oriented. So it's the whole family driven youth guided is kind of a customer service approach on steroids.
Great, Andy. Thank you. Tyler will unmute the lines now. We can take questions and see if anybody has any questions over the phone. Let's see, are we unmuted? We've got a question coming in via the phones are unmuted.
And I'll also say that if we can't get to your question in the next few minutes, then please feel free to call me or email me. My number's there. If you have questions about budget issues, like I said, if you're thinking about renovations, or if you have questions about how much something's cost or whether it's allowable, those sort of budget questions, if you're not sure how to do something, then you would talk to Gwen Simpson. You can call me about that too. If it's something that I can't answer, then I will refer you to her or the appropriate person.
Tyler, the question is, will we get a copy of these slides? The webinar has been recorded, so it's available.
And yes, you'll be able to disseminate it however you want. By Monday, I should have that available for anybody that wants a copy of that, yeah.
Okay. Jen Rountree will make sure that everyone who's on the webinar gets a copy. We'll send it out to all of our grant communities as well.
And we'll have the transcript available too, if there were any notes that somebody wanted to keep.
Okay. Any other questions?
Well, I guess if there are no questions, I just wanted to again offer some encouragement with all of the tribal grants that have received system of care funding in the past. I would say that, that with confidence that all of them have made a difference in their communities for children and families. That it's all made a helped people to connect, to help sort of revive and regenerate culture in terms of being a resource for helping children and families. It's helped to bring different providers together. It's done all kinds of things like that. This is potentially, you know, if you're a social worker like me, you know, you get into social work because, you know, you've got this idea that you want to change the world. And this isn't going to change the world, but it will definitely change your community for the better. And I think if you decide to get this, you know, put in an application and you get funded, it's going to be the most rewarding experience of your professional career. It will also, I guarantee it will be the most challenging as well. Because what we're asking you to do in this grant program is a big thing. It's a very positive thing, but it's also something that's big and can be very challenging, because we're really talking about changing practices that have been you know, sort of done for a long time. So I strongly encourage you guys to apply. If you're not interested in applying and one of your neighbor tribes you think might be, we really want to see a large number of tribes funded, and it's going to take applications coming in to get that done. So that's just my last bit of encouragement, is that this can really make a difference in your communities.
Yes, and Andy, I would add to that this is been a program that has made so much difference in the way that mental health services are perceived and in tribal communities, and breaking down the stigma through creating services that make sense in tribal communities and then pull people in. I would just use a few examples. At Cynthia Glaska, and they're developed a very unique equine-assisted program. Young people who have been through their program have come back to become horse handlers, and as they come back, they bring their siblings or their friends into treatment, really breaking down the stigma of going for help. I'd have to, you know, say similarly at Lummi Nation, of the use of canoe journey to engage youth in culturally based practices, which then opens the door to relationships that bring them into to mental health services, and so many more examples from around the country from our systems of care communities. These are setting the pace for how our children and families are getting help. And so I hope people really do take advantage of this funding announcement.
All right. So I think we're done.
I think that's it.
I would like to thank everybody for taking an hour and a half of your time to call in and listen. Hopefully it wasn't too boring walking through a federal document, but there's good things that can happen. So any questions, feel free to call me. That was not clear in the presentation.
And thank you, Andy, for making this clear and understandable. Taking a big document and digesting it into this many slides is a huge undertaking. So, we did it in in the hour and a half we had, so that's great. Thank you, everyone, for calling in. I think that's the conclusion of our webinar.